The following is a 5-for-2 production.
Hey, ho, fuck Bo! Hey, ho, fuck Bo! Hey, ho, fuck Bo! Hey, ho, fuck Bo!
They lined up at the horseshoe. The neutron man is there too. The Aunt Daughter is on cue. Buckeye Bob.
And it's welcome to episode
they got no victory bell.
Hey, Jesus.
Right. If any of you don't like the Big Ten or Big Ten football, come back in about 15 minutes for the Ozzy Osbourne stories, or just fuck off for the night. But anyway,
or go suck an egg.
We discussed this last week. Ohio State football is every bit the event that a concert is, and the show is called Ticket Stubs. So we're talking about Ohio State football for a little bit.
You got yours, I got mine. I'm not digging them out. I showed them last week. We've already made our point. Now, Kevin, is there any particular Ohio State game that you would like to focus on tonight?
Well, I have one here that you and I saw together, right there. That is, I think you can tell the story to get us started, but I think your parents' neighbors had season tickets or something like that, and they give them tickets occasionally. This was on September 16th of 2006.
2006. I'm just trying to remember. I'm sorry for drawing a blank here, Kev.
Anyway, you got your parents' neighbors' tickets for that game, and you took me as your date. Todd takes me as his date a lot, folks, to these shows. But
hey, look, he usually buys beer and he'll split the parking fees. So that's a good date, if you ask me.
I just don't put out. So, now
neither did any of my other dates. So why would I expect anything
different? Why don't we go back to the very beginning, Todd? You and I both went to Ohio State. There's a reason why we're just talking about Ohio State here today. It's not just because we have
All right. So again, Kevin,
let's to talk about.
Well, we'll back up for a second for the fact that, you know, the name of the show is Ticket Stubs, right? So generally speaking, we talk about concerts that we go to, musical acts that we see. Now, however, in my book, there are a couple special occasions that I will throw in, and this is one of them because, as I mentioned, I believe on last week's episode, now, if you think about it, you buy tickets, you look forward to it, you get good and drunk, you take pictures, you have fun. It's the same damn thing as a concert, except it's just a sporting event.
We've seen a few concerts in the venue, in the very venue where we watch the Buckeyes play.
So I certainly have. Pink Floyd, Genesis, Rolling Stones,
I've seen Metallica there. We saw the Rolling Stones. So, come on.
So, anyhow, all right. So, now, Kevin, should we go all the way back, or start with football games?
Well, I'll go all the way back to say this. When I actually went to school at Ohio State, I could have cared less about football. I really regret that now. My freshman year, I actually was a Michigan home game, and I actually sold my ticket for, I think I went to one game, and then I realized how much money I could make each week selling my ticket. And so I actually was an entrepreneur there for my freshman year. I didn't go to a single game, not even the Michigan game. I made more money off the Michigan game alone than I paid for the whole ticket. So I know. It's very regretful.
This is what I do to Trump supporters when I see them driving on the golf courts in the villages.
Todd, like, I asked you this off the air, but I'll just go ahead and ask you. Are you sure if President Trump calls Kevin Warren from the Big Ten and actually saves Ohio State football, you wouldn't even consider voting for him?
No, hell no. Doesn't matter at all. I look again, and as I told you, Jesus H. Christ could come down here on, you know, himself with his arms around Donald Trump. I still wouldn't vote for the son of a bitch. So, all right.
Okay, fair enough. Now, Todd, I take it from the shame you're giving me, you had a more of a connection with Ohio State football from a younger age.
Well, again, so here's the thing. Now, you're from Ohio. You lived in Ohio all of your life until you went to Ohio State. Never really moved out of Ohio until after graduating from Ohio State. Mm-hmm. So you're an Ohio boy. You're more of an Ohio boy than I am. Mm-hmm. I think I'm a sentimental Ohio boy because, all right, so born in Columbus, born and bred, proud of it. We moved to Pennsylvania when I was about 10 or 11 in 1980, and I was subjected to Penn State fans for a number of years, which I think made me more of a Buckeyes fan than I was before I moved to Pennsylvania. You know, Dad took me to a couple of games. I mean, I remember watching the games on TV. I remember I had the gear. I've got a old Ohio State jersey with 45 on it. Right, you know, like with a little kid size, you know. So I've been a Buckeye fan all my life, but the fact is I didn't really appreciate it until I moved to Pennsylvania away from Ohio and realized, wait a minute, not everyone's a Buckeye? Really?
It's not the only team?
I mean, my mom tells the story of when we first moved to Pennsylvania and Mom and Dad had a little homecoming party for all of Dad's, members of the school board. And it was Ohio State versus Penn State in the Fiesta Bowl. And they beat our ass. And, I couldn't understand. I said, Mom, why are all these people rooting for Penn State? I didn't get it. I did not understand. So again, my pride of our state came through living in other areas. And when I came back to Ohio State, you know, for college, my freshman year, I swore that I was going to be at the Ohio State Michigan football game. And I had a good buddy, Tim Schaefer. You may have met him before. And so Tim's dad was a Michigan guy. I was obviously a Buckeye. And from fifth grade on, we had made a deal that when we get to college, he said he was going to go to Michigan. He went to, a different, we're not going to mention. But, Gettysburg. What are they? The Bullets? The Charging Hard-Ons? We don't know. Their mascot's embarrassing. But so Tim went to Gettysburg. I went to Ohio State. But when I went to Ohio State, I still ended up getting tickets for the Ohio State-Michigan football game. And that was the last game that Earl Bruce coached the Buckeyes. And also the last time the Buckeyes actually beat Michigan for a long damn time. Because we had 9 years of John fucking Cooper after that. So
painful years. But now we've gone a full decade without a loss.
Decade. We're like 17 years up on the Wolverines right now.
Well, total, but a decade straight, you know, not counting that year they took away from us, but whatever.
Hmm. Well, and of course, this year is going to have an asterisk anyhow. So, even if the Big Ten and the Pac-10 don't play, and I realize we're talking college football as compared to concert stories, but you know what? Go fuck yourself.
We'll get back on track. But
go ahead. Show. We can do what we want.
That's right.
Episode
O, folks. We're talking about Ohio State.
Exactly right. So, if the Buckeyes don't play, if the Pac-10 are out, it's going to be one giant asterisk for every single team who does decide to play through this Trump virus right now. So, again, unless everybody plays or nobody plays, that's it. That's the only way this thing should be. So, that's the way I look at it. Kevin, your opinion?
Yeah, exactly. If the SEC and the ACC play, it means nothing. So, anyway, But you know,
it's just going to be Alabama and Clemson once again. So who gives a shit? Right.
Roll Tide over a cliff. But anyway, we'll get back to specifically.
Kevin, that's fighting words.
I said over a cliff. Okay. I said Roll Tide over a cliff.
I think you said over Clemson. My hearing's going away.
No, over a cliff. I could care less about either team. Let's get back to specifically Ohio State. I'll tell you where I really started to become a fan, and I mean, like a lot of things, this can help become a fan. It was partying at tailgates, specifically our old friend, the Schmoogate, a friend of Todd and I's, ran a really nice tailgate for many years, right behind Lane
and
Avenue.
And really, you know, you got to thank Dennis O'Brien for that hookup. Mm-hmm. So my cousin Dennis, once again.
Todd, the apartment complex where we went to Smoogate, they've completely walled in the area. It's gone. It's just it's no more. So there you go.
Well, buddy, no offense. That tailgate got pretty lame in the last 5 years, anyhow.
When all the tailgaters at one tailgate are like in their 40s and 50s, and all the other tailgaters around you are in their teens and 20s, yeah, you kind of look like the creepy old man hanging out. But you know, what are you gonna do? The one
plastic surgery, Botox.
What I was gonna mention, speaking of the tailgates, the year that Happy Heather calls him Happy Gilmore because he looks like Adam Sandler. But anyway, the year that he coached the Buckeyes, and we weren't that good when we were between.
That guy never had a chance. Man.
So anyway, tickets were easy to come by that year. And one afternoon, we were walking to the tailgate, the Schmoogate, and a guy was standing on the corner selling the tickets. And I just offered him, I said, hey, man, I'll give you $20. He's like, well, give me $20 a piece. And I said, nah, that's all right. And we continued to walk on. He kind of followed me. He said, what, it's not worth $20 a piece to go to the game? I said, nah, I wasn't really planning on it. I'm just going to get drunk. He's like, all right, give me the $20 for both of them. Heather's about half a block ahead of me. I get chasing her down, like, all right, honey, let's go have a few beers and we're going to the game. So we pulled a loss that day to the other team up north. But, you know. We've gone to a few spring games. We would have gone this year if they had one, but that's usually fun. You know, you just get to go into the stadium and drink and party for no real reason, and you don't have to worry about a loss. So,
well, I hate to admit this, Kevin, and you know, God bless both mom and dad, who you know we've had on the show and you've met several times before. God bless mom and dad for paying for my education for 4 years at Ohio State, and I got out in 4 years even. I was at least that respectful.
It took
if
me.
I'm gonna spend it, if I'm spending their money, I'm getting out in 4 years even.
It took me five. That's why we graduated together. But mom and dad weren't paying for mine. But I do thank mom and dad for being economically disadvantaged. And so you know, Kevin went to Ohio State on the old grant plan.
Well, dude, you know, if wishes were fishes, we'd all think of swim. But you know, my dad got me a tits job at Ohio State before I even started school. The summer before I started my freshman year, I lived with my two cousins who were living in University Village down there, you know. And so I stayed with them for like a couple of weeks, and dad got me a job like right on, not South Campus, but, you know, the far off campus, the East Campus, West Campus, whatever it's called. And dude, if I had just stayed in that apartment and kept that job for a year, I would have been in state, had a job, gotten half my damn tuition paid for, you know, and probably would have gotten into public access TV and stand-up comedy long before I did in 93. You know, again, I look at big people. I'm not complaining about my life. I'm very happy where I am right now. I'm just saying, you know, sometimes when you look back on your decisions over your life, you kind of go, whoop.
What were they thinking? Yeah, I get it. Now, Todd, I can steer this back to music because we discussed this. But, you know, a lot of very popular...
the topic of the show.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. A lot of popular sports teams, it's not an uncommon for them to have fans dedicated specifically to them. Like the Packers, you know, they have like the cheesehead bands and pretty much every city, if you really go and dig into the sports fandom, there's some kind of a novelty band dedicated, you know, to that team. But I got to say, Ohio State Buckeyes probably have the greatest tribute band, band that specifically deals not just with the Ohio State football team itself, but with a specific game and a specific day and a specific.
I think I know where you're going with this one, Kevin.
I'm talking about our good friends in the Dead Schembechlers. Let's hear it for the Dead Schembechlers. Right, right. And
which is really just, you know, the best guys of Watershed, the dork from fucking Michigan.
Michigan?
Where is he from?
No, he's from Jersey. Lou's from Jersey, but...
That explains it.
At least he grew up loving the Buckeyes, so we got to give him that.
I'll give Lou a little bit of credit, but the guy is kind of a dork.
He's definitely a dedicated fan. We got to give him that. But if you don't know anything about the Dead Schembechlers, folks, just go look him up on YouTube. It's high concept.
The guy's written like, what, 27 books. He's personal friends with Hunter S. Thompson when he's alive. I'm just jealous. That's really what it comes down to. I'm just bitter that I'm not him.
Serious. He's a serious XM DJ.
He's written two records with Watershed. Well, Colin won't even call me back for this fucking podcast. The guy's written two records with him.
The latest reply back I got from Colin when I tried to do the schedule was, I'll let you know what works. So we'll see. Stay tuned, folks. We'll see what happens with episode W. But
I think W is going to be a washout.
So the Dead Schembechlers are a band that sings songs about hating.
Hating Michigan.
It's great stuff.
I hate Michigan. Fuck the Wolverines. That's a song.
Here's a Dead Schembechlers set list with blood, Wolverine blood all over it.
Oh, I like that. That's nice.
Yes, covered in Wolverine blood.
That reminds me of one of my holiday form letters, the suicide episode.
Oh, Lord, a whole nother matter. Tune into What the Hell Was That? Maybe you'll get that story. But, Todd, because of the Dead Schembechlers, you and I had the chance to be part of a HBO documentary in 2006, right there.
All right, now what's your memory of that show? Because I've got a little story I can throw in here.
Well, historically, we know that it was the day that the real Bo Schembechler actually passed away. And I'm going to tell you what class guys, the guys in Watershed and the Dead Schembechlers are, folks. They have a band called the Dead Schembechlers. They had already killed Bo years before he actually died.
Yeah. It was a long-standing joke.
Right. On the day that he did pass away, the Dead Schembechlers played their biggest show in their career, a sold-out show at the Newport Music Hall in Columbus, Ohio, that Todd and I have talked about many times on this episode.
You couldn't ask for any worse timing than this.
Yes, exactly. And they turned around and they gave all of the profits, 100% of them, to Bo Schembechler's Heart of a Champion.
Well, not only that, but they also changed their name for the night.
Yes, to the, Bastard Sons of Woody or something like that. I know. It didn't stick.
They changed the goddamn name.
Now, as they pointed out at that show, Bo was a Buckeye first.
True.
He won every national championship that he was involved with as an assistant coach at the Buckeyes. He never won one. Bo never won a national title. Bo never won a national title. Over 24. But anyway, so HBO filmed a documentary, and it was around the same time. It was basically a documentary about the greatest rivalry.
It was the same year that Ohio State was number one and Michigan was number two.
That's right. It was a documentary focused specifically on the greatest rivalry in sports history. It's called The Rivalry. You can go to HBO.
I just recall the night of the premiere of the HBO. Do you remember? Do you recall, Todd?
I don't actually.
Okay.
No.
Well,
I drink a lot.
The night the documentary was actually going to premiere on HBO, Todd was on his way over to hang out at my house. And Saturday night, I think, in Columbus, Ohio, Todd was on his way over with some beers. And I don't know why we, Heather and I started the documentary without you, but we did. But we were about 10 minutes in, and I stopped it. And I looked at Heather, and I said, we have to wait for Todd to watch this documentary. I could tell it was going to be that powerful. And Heather had never been a Buckeye fan whatsoever up to this point. I think she had went to a couple of tailgates, maybe just solely for the, you know, beer drinking
aspect of it.
But you arrived at my house and we restarted the program from the beginning. And towards the end of the documentary, there's a line where it says, there are some elderly people that want to live just a little, one more fall. Just so they can see Ohio State beat Michigan one more time. And Todd looked at me and he said, is it okay if I'm crying? I looked at Todd and I said, well, I've been crying for the last half hour. And Heather speaks up and said, well, I've been crying for the whole thing. And Heather has been the biggest Ohio State Buckeye fan from that day forward. She puts both of us to shame, and she didn't even go to the school. I mean, she will whoop a Wolverine's ass faster than anyone. So if you have any questions, folks, go watch that documentary, and you too might feel some of the magic that Todd and I are trying to impart here.
For sure. For sure. For sure. And I tell you, buddy, you know, not only am I just proud of being Ohio, you know, even being an Ohio State graduate doesn't mean that fucking much to me. It's the people that I met at Ohio State that mean the most. Mm-hmm. The degree, the diploma, yeah, the diploma, fine. Sitting right here, right above my Kiss originals, the Love Gun, and the Kiss.
And both mean as much to you.
So again, you know, The people that I met and the experiences that I had is what means the most to me about Ohio State. And to sum up those experiences, you have to talk about the Ohio State Michigan football game. So again, you know,
yep,
I think that's why we had to mention it tonight. So
absolutely. Know. If you haven't been there, folks, you just don't know. I hope you could at least find some enjoyment in our enthusiasm over the subject. And hope you could relate it to your own, you know, concert experiences or
college football teams.
Exactly.
Or whatever, you know,
I'm sure everybody has, you know, their own little, their own little patch of, you know, of sports fandom.
Look, folks, it
ain't like Ohio State.
It doesn't matter if you went to, Ohio State or Ohio University or Ohio Wesleyan, you know, everybody's got a team they root for. Everybody's got a bumper sticker they put on the back of their car. And everyone's got a jersey they pull out once a year during football season. So, That's why we're talking about this during Ticket Stubs tonight.
And hopefully we're going to get some football this year, but we'll see.
Go Bucks.
Go Bucks. All right, we'll be back with some real concert stories here about the
O's. We got one more O. So.
And if I got a few, but yeah, our main event, Ozzy Osbourne.
Ozzy, I love you all. I love you all.
All right, we'll be back here on Ticket Stubs.
Well, hey, I guess we're back with episode O. All right, folks, we've talked about enough about Ohio State.
Hopefully, if you tuned out, you've come back now because we told you that we'd have some Ozzy stories about, you know, halfway through.
Finally, it's like Bill Hicks finally getting to the dick jokes.
Right? Todd, I thought before we got into Ozzy real quick, I just have a few honorable mentions of the other O's. We had mentioned them last week, but I wanted to mention the Oak Ridge Boys because I have now dubbed them. You remember how I dubbed Megadeth the Cheap Trick of thrash metal? Well, Oak Ridge Boys, we're going to dub them the Cheap Trick of country music because I've seen them purely as an opening act. I've seen it with Loretta and Charlie Daniels Band.
Well, I always called the Oak Ridge Boys the same thing as John Denver, and my dad can confirm this. I always consider them the concerts that didn't count.
I have a few of those I've mentioned, but
now looking back now, I'm so glad that I can say that I saw John Denver and I saw the Oak Ridge Boys, and I'm pretty sure. All right, so I think for John Denver, it was the opening band was Eddie Rabbit.
And nice,
good. Oak Ridge Boys, I'm pretty sure it was who's the guy that sings Raindrops Falling on Your Head?
Burt Bacharach?
No, he might have wrote it, but
Johnny Mathis? Johnny Mathis, I don't know. One of those guys. I'm not sure. I'm really not sure who had the big hit with that. It's escaping me right now. So
I put pressure on See, look, Kevin, I assume you're the fucking musical genius here.
I do plan for these shows, Todd, but every now and then, you hit me with something. I just, you stump me, but. So
I stumped Kevin tonight.
Another band I wanted to mention, the Outlaws, Green Grass and High Tides Forever. So I saw them once, the great Huey Thomason, God bless him, rest in peace. I also saw Huey once in one of the lineups of Skinner. It was probably, I don't know exactly what year, but I was like, that year for Lynyrd Skynyrd was literally like a classic rock super group because you had Huey Thomason from the Outlaws. You had, of course, the members of Skinner that were still alive at the time, and then you had Ricky Medlock
from Blackfoot.
Yep, so, at one point, Huey Thomason contributed to that, so shout out to Huey. And then, this is just an aside, and this is going to lead us into our main event, but if you've ever been to an Ozzy Osbourne concert, he always starts all of his concerts, kind of like Metallica, with a specific piece of music. And it is a piece from an opera. It's a very famous piece of music. It's been in tons of movies. Exactly. He even kind of modeled the Diary of a Madman intro after it. But it's from an opera called Carmina Burana by Carl Orff.
Which, oh, God, take no culture.
Todd, I've been to the rap shows. I've been to the country shows here on Ticket Stubs. And yes, I went to see, because I'm an Ozzy fan, I went to the opera to see Carmina Burana at the Ohio Theater, also an O. We can just tie this all in. And I went just for that one piece of music.
Play it, bitch! Play it, bitch!
Fortunately, it's the opening piece of the opera, but it's also the closing. So I sat through the whole thing just to hear the damn thing twice. So.
Can you imagine being the one guy heckling her throughout the entire show going, hey, man, play number 9.78!
Play O Fortuna! So anyway, so that leads us to our main event of the evening. Ozzy.
I love you all! I love you all! He didn't really mean that, folks. But, he said it every night.
When did you discover Ozzy, Todd?
Gosh. We're going back to middle school, 7th, 8th grade. That's about when. All right, here's what it was. Now,
okay.
We have played the Ozzy Osbourne footage of me going to the Randy Rhoads crash site.
Mm-hmm. Over on What the Hell Was That on YouTube.
As well as the negative comments from whoever had to say one. Mr. Negative Nelly, whoever you are. But that's all right. Hey, that's okay. The camera shots did suck. Look, I was on my own, motherfucker. I didn't have a camera person. It was just me, bitch.
But you have been to the Randy Rhoads crash site, and he hasn't.
I have stepped on the site where Randy Rhoads crashed into that motherfucking bus, bitches. I have been there. I am an Ozzy Osbourne fan. And I have been a fan since the day I heard about that accident happening. And I gotta say, Kevin, I swear to Christ, I didn't give two shits about Ozzy Osbourne. Mm-hmm. until the day I heard about that Randy Rhoads crash.
What was it about the crash that just because was he was a rock star? Or?
Traumatic. For me, as a 12-year-old child who was just kind of getting into rock and roll and admiring these people who had succeeded and made it from my age to theirs and achieved these goals of putting out records and playing stadiums and you know, and being the rock star that I once certainly wanted to be as a little kid. I mean, to me, that was an amazing thing. And when Randy Rhoads' life was snuffed out, it was a traumatic blow to me. It made me realize that life is a precious thing and that our time here on Earth, folks, is very, very limited. You know, we only have a short time to make our mark. And, you know, it's not about ego. It's not about what you can do for yourself. It's what you can offer to the world. And that's what Randy Rhoads and Ozzy Osbourne did, is they offered this idea and this concept to the world.
Yeah,
you know,
it was definitely, I mean, that was lightning in a bottle, those first two albums. That's actually how I discovered Ozzy. I was familiar with Black Sabbath, and my older brothers and sisters had Black Sabbath albums, but the one I always remembered was Heaven and Hell, and on the back of that album, the singer is Ronnie Dio. So I didn't know who this Ozzy guy was, but one day I was like fiddling around in my brother's van. I was just looking through his cassettes and seeing what kind of cool stuff he had in his cool old 70s van, and he had a cassette for this album here, Blizzard of Oz, and just look at Ozzy, look how insane he looks on this cover, and he's got the cross up, he's about to bash the cross into the ground, and I've
he's
talked about it
drunk.
Before I
talked let's, about let's face it, he's drunk.
Oh god, drunk, high, can you be anything
hey Ozzy,
than drunk or high?
Hold the cross up. Hold the cross up. What?
Ah. Okay, well, do you know what I mean? But anyway, so he had this, so I was kind of like scared of him. He had that Alice Cooper, you remember I've talked about how I was originally scared of Gene Simmons, and I was originally scared of Alice Cooper. Ozzy
as a Catholic boy, I would think you would be.
Ozzy had that same aura, but again, I was attracted to it. So I don't know if you remember the Entertainment Tonight special with Ozzy back then, like when the first album was out. All right, so that
if it was on Entertainment Tonight, I guarantee I saw it.
Okay, well, that's when I became a fan. You can go on YouTube now, you know, thanks to the glory of technology, and actually watch this clip. But it was an interview with Ozzy at the time, and he was in his full, like, regalia, like a cape and, you know, the makeup and, like, long fingernails. And, yeah, you know, the like, the evil red cape with the big, like,
horns.
It was like, who is this, you know? And he talked about being crazy. How about, I know that I'm crazy, you know? But it's like, oh, my God, they're letting this crazy guy loose on stage.
It's on my television, Mom.
So shortly after that, the album Speak of the Devil was released, if you will remember this. Now, MTV had a concert at the same time. MTV had a concert at the same time. It was on Halloween night of 1982 or 83, and Speak of the Devil. Now, the MTV concert was actually Ozzy original songs. It wasn't all Sabbath covers like the album. Now, I had seen the videos already that were clipped out of this concert for Iron Man and Paranoid. And in the Iron Man video, if you recall, a laser cross spins around and turns upside down. So I knew my mom was not going to be cool with this if she saw this in the concert. So, Todd, I built a tent out of a blanket. I put it on my big console TV, put some books to weight it down, and I crawled under the tent and sat watch the TV so as not to offend my dear Satan mother with the Ozzy.
Kevin, you know you're still going to hell, buddy. You're still going to hell.
Now, Todd, I think I've told you this story as well before, but you know, I went to Catholic school. Speaking of Randy Rhoads, every year on the anniversary of his passing, I would, in religion class, I would drive my religion teachers crazy by, I would like to pray for the soul of Randy Rhoads.
Dude, I'm telling you. All right, the next time you come down, I'm taking you to the site because you need to be there with me.
I would love to go. Thank you. Yes, yes, please, please. I would love to go. I'll go trespass with you for sure. But okay, so now I was going on a field trip with my Catholic school. We were going to go to the cathedral in Columbus, Ohio.
We're still talking about Ozzy, right? Yes,
very much so. Very much so. Just hang tight, buddy. I know you get a little antsy with some of my stories, but hang in there. You're going to like this one. So you remember my dad, Raymond Motto. So the night before the field trip, we're at Rinks, where I bought my Motley Crue album, where I've talked about, you know, seeing the Metallica album. That was where I got all my records as a kid. But so I ran over to the cassette section because I was like, all right, I'm going to be on the bus tomorrow. I'm going to have my jam box. I can't listen to vinyl. I don't have time to tape it. I'm going to just buy a couple Ozzy cassettes. So I grabbed the cassettes for Diary of a Madman, and I grabbed the cassette for Speak of the Devil. So I go run to my dad near the checkout counter. I'm like, Dad, Dad, can I buy these? My dad, he's like, let me see them. He looks at him.
Let me see him.
He saw the Diary of a Madman. Then he looks at the cover for Speak of the Devil. Yes, he sees this like gel dripping out of Ozzy's mouth.
The gel did it.
God bless Dad. He looked at him and he handed them back to me. Said, "Just don't tell your mother." And he bought them for me.
Show your mother. Don't show your mother.
And he bought them for me. Thank you, Dad. So next day on the bus, I'm playing Ozzy. And it comes time for Iron Man. Now our priest at the time, Father Klima, he was driving the bus. And the bus was kind of noisy. It was an old, you know, ratty bus. But we stopped at the rest area to take a pee. And Father Klima heard something coming out of the back.
I can't fucking hear you!
Father Klima marches to the back of the bus, looks me directly in the eye, says, "Is that Ozzy Osbourne that I hear?" I'm like, yes, Father. He said, "If I hear that again on this trip, I will throw your entire jam box out the window of the bus." So I switched to AC/DC. Apparently he didn't mind Hell's Bells and, you know, Put Your Love Into Me and Shake a Leg or, you know, whatever. So whatever, Father. Father also got pissed at me once because I played Black Sabbath during a prayer service in the chapel at school. So, you know.
Well, I'm sure he had no problem with the song Big Balls.
So, Todd, when was your first Ozzy concert? This is all leading up to the story.
All right, first Ozzy, I feel like we've almost kind of discussed it before, but all right, so.
We probably have.
Ozzy with Metallica and Cliff Burton. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, we missed most of Metallica. Mom and Dad, me and Hoop, driving up to some bumfuck college town in Pennsylvania, got lost on the way up, couldn't find our way to the arena once we got to the college. We missed pretty much all of Metallica except for like Seek and Destroy and Am I Evil. That's all.
Got to see Cliff, but you got to see Cliff.
So we got to see Cliff. Saw Ozzy come down with the big crown and, you know, the whole thing and, you know, his big bouffant hairdo. And so I saw that tour. I saw him again like 89, I want to say. I've seen at least three Ozzfests, which I found surprising going back on the list. I'm like, God damn, I saw Black Sabbath three times with Ozzy? You know, so I've seen him a few times, you know, but I mean, again, it's one of those things where, all right, so if you had to rank the top three of your, like, metal influences early on, I would have to go Ozzy, Maiden, Priest.
Okay.
That's the way I, you know, was brought up.
Gotcha. So, well, Ozzy, of course, I discovered Black Sabbath because of the Speak of the Devil album, which I just showed a little bit.
Sure, I had no idea who Black Sabbath was. That
I really didn't.
Scared the shit out of me.
We had a teacher my eighth grade year in school, and his name was Mr. Graham, and Mr. Graham loved Black Sabbath, and I remember he was trying to be cool, you know, cool with guys in the class one day, and he's like, hey, yeah, I went out and bought that new Ozzy record because had all my favorite Black Sabbath songs on it, but. I actually saw Ozzy, Todd, the tour before, on the Bark at the Moon tour. rocket the moon. And I've mentioned this before. The opening act was your mom's favorite metal band, except on the same tour that you saw them with Kiss, Balls to the Wall, man. It was supposed to be Motley Crue on Shout the Devil. I got gypped from that, and we got accepted instead. But they were good, but they weren't Motley Crue. But there's a stub from that. It's a great Charleston Civic Center concert. So, of course, I rushed the stage for Ozzy.
I was going to say, I'm sure you hopped the wall.
Rushed the stage for Ozzy. God bless you. Now, Todd, we've talked about pictures here on the past on the show. And the first time we did, you mentioned...
Got some?
Got some pictures of this show. And here's a perfect example of the hand in the way here, right here. Can we see this, folks? Look, right there. There it is.
Yep. There's Ozzy. That looks like my Iron Maiden photos. Yep, from 83.
There's Ozzy back there. Here, this one's even better. Here's the guy's head in front of me. With a little bit.
Straight shot of the guy's head.
Little tiny Ozzy there in the background.
Right.
Right. And then one more. Here's head and hands. Not Ozzy. And folks, you had to wait 2 weeks, you know, back then to find out these pictures.
You're like really hoping. You're thinking you got the greatest close-up photo of all time.
And then you get it back, like, fuck.
Polaroids back. Oh, what a disappointment. Oh, it hurt.
Yep. So yeah, my second show. This is a life event happened on the evening of my first Ozzy concert. We've talked about the first time I got drunk was when I heard AC/DC's Hell's Bells album when I was 12 years old. Well, the first time I ever smoked a joint was for some reason riding home from the Ozzy concert at the Bark at the Moon tour. It's like, I think one of the guys, I think, bought it at the show or something. No, it's like, why didn't we do this before the show? But I just remembered, I of course, like a lot of people their first time, I didn't catch any kind of buzz whatsoever. I remember going home and I was so worried my parents were going to know that he did drugs. And I remember sitting on the couch for like 2 hours, like, when's the buzz going to get here? I was probably high, but I didn't know.
Did you watch, like, were you sitting on the couch with your parents? Or were you?
No, I got home and like my mom was up just to make sure I got home, and then she went to bed. You know, it wasn't anything like that. So I made it through that bit of paranoia. But then I just like, I was waiting to, you know, to feel some kind of a buzz come on. And I just, I don't know.
I've had Ozzy Osbourne nights where, you know, you get all kinds of fucked up. And you come home, and you get to the front door, you know, you put the key in, you turn it real, real quiet, you know, you get in the door and walk up to your room, you almost make it into bed, and just boom, I just fall your ass down, make a huge noise, next thing you know, mom and dad are up. Oh my Christ, what's going on?
Todd's home.
Yeah. Oh God.
So my second show was actually the tour that you saw, you know, with Cliff. So that was, I've told the story on our Metallica episode about torturing everyone in my car with Metallica music all the way to that show. And the war in the mall between the Ozzy and the Metallica factions after the concert. So later, also, I mean, I told my best Ozzy concert story in our second episode when we were talking about Black Sabbath. We talked about the Ozzfest riots.
Well, I hate to say it, look, my best Sabbath story was meeting Ryan James Dio. So we've already blown that one anyhow. So at this point, look, we were talking about the Buckeyes. We both love Ozzy. God bless you, Ozzy.
Sabbath. There's a cool Sabbath picture from...
Have you listened to him on his recent, podcast or anything? I mean...
No, I haven't seen the paranormal stuff.
Look, I realize the guy has Parkinson's, but Christ, I'm just drunk. That guy sounds bad.
God bless Ozzy. I'm glad he's still with us. I mean, who would have thunk that all four members of Black Sabbath would still be here today, so...
Naomi's close.
Now, I know, Ozzy had, Ozzy's kind of a hit or miss thing live, but the last two times I saw him with Black Sabbath on the final two tours, He sounded good. He sounded really good. So, I mean, he went out strong, I think. If Ozzy never plays a show again, you know, he's got nothing to prove to anybody. He's a punchline. You know, everybody can have their fun bagging on Ozzy, but he's got nothing to prove to anybody.
Why is he even trying to put out singles at this point? What the hell? What, I mean, like, is Sharon just trying to squeeze one last little fucking nickel out of the motherfucker?
She spent all the money he's already made, so.
I mean, look, how much Botox does the bitch need? I mean, you
know. Oh, Lord. So, Todd, what would you say then, as we kind of try to wrap up, what would you say was your favorite Ozzy memory live?
Gosh. Well, all right, first of all, the first show, Mom and Dad taking me and Hoop, you know, driving up to PA to go see it. Yeah, we saw Ozzy. He was, you know, fine, you know. Second time I saw him, Bram got me free tickets. God bless him, through the radio station at the time. And that's another story, you know, but I mean,
I think, I mean, obviously getting to see
Ozzfest,
obviously for me, getting to see him with Metallica and then Cliff Burton alive. But my first concert, I still remember, cause it was my first Ozzy concert was my second concert total. And I mean, I just remember being so excited when he came on stage in a coffin and like the coffin up and just, it's like, it's fucking Ozzy. And I mean,
he's not dead.
I don't,
I told you he's not dead.
I don't think, I mean, you know, it's like, I guess it's like they say about doing some kind of a heavy drug or something. You're always like trying to find, you know, to find that first you know, punch. Oh my God, Todd, wait a minute. Hold on. I own one picture disc in my entire vinyl collection. Look at all that vinyl behind me, folks. I have one picture disc, and it happens to be the same picture disc that Todd has right there. What do you know? You are not seeing double, folks. Do not adjust. Do not adjust.
I didn't keep mine wrapped. Mine's all beat to shit.
Mine's not wrapped, dude. That's a sleeve there. So I don't like the sound of picture discs.
Wait, I got that.
Nice. What's that one? What's on that one? Well, read it. Nice. It's got the runes from Speak of the Devil, so yeah, it's something off of there.
NIB and something of the universe.
Nice. I'll tell you how much of an Ozzy geek I am. I once sat down and fortunately I was already a Lord of the Rings fan, so I knew that there was a rune alphabet in the back of the Lord of the Rings, and I sat and translated all of these runes all over the Ozzy album. I have the translation right here in the drawer if you'd like to
a fucking moron. How much time did you waste translating this bullshit?
I know what it says.
That's what I thought it said.
It does actually say something, so you know, but it's a tribute to Randy Rhoads is what it is. So
yeah,
so we bring this back full circle to Randy. God bless him. And
well, shit, now you make me feel bad for making fun of it now. God,
you deserve it. Well, Todd, I'm gonna let you off the hook here because I think you're having an Ozzy moment of your own.
Well, look, we still got P, Q, R, S, T, V, W, X, and who gives a fucking Z? So, you know.
We already bagged a good extra story, so I know
we got X halfway done, folks. I'm not going to tell you about it. Let's not talk about it.
We'll talk about it. Very special.
Secret. X marks the spot.
And so, Todd, as we record this episode right now, episode J is airing, and I think right about now, all the Ticket Stubs fans.
About Journey with Dad.
That's right. I think everybody is getting to meet. Meet Dr. Dale for the first time right now.
Dr. Dale Baker.
God bless him. God bless him. And God bless Dr. Dale and your mom for taking you to see Ozzy Osbourne at a young age.
And my sister Lee was just in town this week, which you will see in several weeks on down the line.
Right.
But, you know, look, I'm very blessed, Kevin, as you know, to have a great family. Right. You've got a great family.
Amen.
I hope you have a great family. And you know, and that's what Ticket Stubs is truly all about.
Thank you all for being a part of our Ticket Stubs
family experience here. we want you to just come on in, grab a beer. Let's tell some stories, huh? Let's just have some fun. Forget politics. We're just chit-chatting and having a good time.
That's right. Talking about rock and roll. Timeless rock and roll.
All right, so Kevin, what do we got next week, buddy?
Next week, well, obviously...
there's a big P I can think of.
Yep. We may have a special guest next week. I think may have somebody talked into finally making their podcast debut.
I got to take a big P is all I got to say. All right. Hold on. Before you... Go on with your list. I got one for mine. Go.
Next week, we are going to obviously talk about Pearl Jam. Lots and lots of bands. I'm gonna mark this for an edit point and a dissolve.
Now here's one that I don't necessarily know we saw them together, but we were probably there at the same time.
Okay. That's right. Next week we will tell at least 2 Pink Floyd stories. And depending on what you consider Pink Floyd, maybe more.
Pink Floyd, baby.
Right.
So we got some Pink Floyd stories to tell.
I got a really good story about that specific concert. So I think everybody will enjoy it.
Lest we not forget that little old band from Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania.
The Spectres?
I believe we've mentioned before. and the kick stories and whatnot, but there's a P band that I've seen a few times. Kevin, you've probably seen them once or twice, I do believe.
Let's see, I think you're talking about Mr. Brett Michaels and Poison. I also have Pantera story.
Patrick and
I have Pantera stories. Dolly Parton. We talked about Pearl Jam.
Yeah.
Tom Petty.
Oh, we got plenty of Petty stories.
Fish.
Yeah, I can tell you a Fish story.
The Police.
Yeah, oh yeah, we were there the same night.
Yep. Primus, who I was supposed to see this year on my birthday, and I have a good Public Enemy story. So we got an action packed episode next week.
Well, dude, we both saw Primus open for Rush.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if we.
I was supposed to see them play Rush this year.
I don't know if we saw the same Public Enemy show. Was that at the Newport?
Yes, it was. It was
where Rage Against the Machine was supposed to open.
Yes, and they did not. But my buddy Kit Grossweiler and his band, the Poets of Heresy, they got the nod. So good for them. they didn't quite make the splash that the Rage Against the Machine did.
Yeah. But, yeah, well, there's 2 shows we can agree upon, and, yeah.
All right.
I'm sure we will have plenty more to discuss come next week.
That's right. Lots and lots and lots of peas. So stick around. Tune in again next week on...
Ticket Stubs!